Last time we saw the Rutherford's nuclear model of atoms. However, we got disconnected. So I'll repeat this again. So we saw that there were some flaws in Thomson's atomic model, that Thomson considered protons are uniformly distributed over entire space of the atom, which was later to just verify this, Rutherford devised an experiment, and in this experiment, he used an alpha particle source. It's a radiation, and by this time, radioactivity was discovered. And we know in radioactivity, three different kinds of particles. These are rays as well. They get emitted. It's alpha particle, beta particles, and gamma particles. These particles, they behaves like we will see later on that all the particles are. Waves are particles, so it's called a duality of the wave particle duality. We'll see later on, just in today's class only. So what he did was he used alpha light source, and he bombarded this alpha light source on he used radon. So a stream of high energy alpha particles from a radioactive source. So it was radon he used, and he directed it to a thin foil, which thickness was around 100 nanometers, so a quite thin alpha, thin gold plate he used. And he surrounded it with the phosphorescent material, it was zinc sulfide, so that even if any particle which crosses the gold foil, if it goes outside and it will fall on this phosphorescent material, it will blink, it will glow there. Even if some if it get reflected anywhere at whatever angle, mostly it's a very other than a small hole, everything it was surrounded circularly by the this fluorescent screen. And he bombarded this particle and this I have written, the thin foil had a circular fluorescent zinc sulfide screen around it. Whenever alpha particle struck the screen, a tiny flash of light was produced at the point wherever it fall on this screen. The result of scattering experiment disproves the Thomson model of atom. It disproves how it disproves. So we'll see this, how it disproves the Thomson's model. So what he found was most of the particle, I mean, his observation passed through gold foil undeflected. What does it mean? Most of the space of the atom is empty mostly, which doesn't stop alpha particles to pass through. And the second observation, a very few alpha particles, that means 1 in 20,000 bounced back. That is, got reflected with the same path, with a 180 degree reflection. And a small fraction of alpha particles was deflected by a small angle, like we see here. A very few, and the rays, these are particles, these are rays, there will be many thousands. A few, just to show, to distinguish, a few rays have been shown. So what he concluded, based on his observation of his experiment, that most of the space in the atom is empty, as most of the alpha particle passed through the foil undeflected. A few positively charged alpha particle were deflected. The deflection must be due to enormous repulsive force, showing the positive charge in the atom is not distributed throughout the atom. This is where Thomson's model fails. It says that positive charge is distributed through uniformly throughout the atom. But Rutherford experiment doesn't verify it. It says that it is not uniformly distributed. The positive charge, what he concluded, the positive charge has to be concentrated in a very small volume that repelled and deflected the positively charged alpha particle. And so Rutherford later on calculated what could be the radius of what he said, that whatever this positive charge particle, it is confined in a very small space, and he named it as a nucleus. We'll see it in the next slide. And based on this, he calculated the volume of the atom and also the volume of the radius. Perhaps he found it a volume of the radius in the order of 10 to the power minus 10 meter. sorry, radius of the radius of the atom in 10 to the power minus 10 meter. What the radius of nucleus in the 10 to the power minus order of 10 to the power minus 15 meter. You can see the 10 to the power minus 10 is a larger number than 10 to the power minus 15. From by mathematics, you can see you should not get confused here. So to assume that how bigger, how a smaller a nucleus could be, you can assume that a circular cricket ground of having radius of 5 kilometer, put a cricket ball in that ground, and the whatever this is how the you can relate the proportion of the size of or maybe the volume of the nucleus in comparison to the atom. So then the nuclear model of based on his experiment and conclusions, Rutherford suggested a nuclear model of atom, and this the three points that he suggested. And the first is the positive charge and most of the mass of atom is densely concentrated in extremely small region. He named it as nucleus, as I said earlier. The nucleus is surrounded by electrons moving in a very, very high speed around it in circular paths. He called these paths as orbit. So electrons and nucleus are held together by an electrostatic force of attractions. These are three points that he shared that in his nuclear model of atom. It's called nuclear model because first time he suggested that there is a nucleus in atom. So, but the problem is, even though he definitely, but he got two very good things. One thing he suggested that most of the mass of the atom is concentrated in a very small volume, that is a nucleus, and the rest part, which is, it is not exactly empty, but quite like an empty-like space, where only electrons reside, which has very small size, a very small mass as well. So, but then the problem was by the time Maxwell has also gave a theory of electromagnetic radiation. This kind of thing, physics was developing enormously at that time. And based on that, what this theory suggests that if a particle is doing an accelerated motion, means accelerated motion, particle is in accelerated motion, then it will radiate its energy, and if it is not getting energy from any other source like atoms and like electrons, we see it is not getting energy from any other source if in an isolated atom, so it will lose its energy because it is radiating some energy, so it will continuously lose its energy, and slowly its radius around the nucleus will decrease, and it will follow a spiral path and fall into the nucleus. And people have calculated this time could be around 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. So very small time. You see how small time a second is. Means 10 to the power minus 8 seconds, the existence of atom will not be destroyed. If atom will not exist, no molecule will exist, because atoms form molecules combining different proportions, different kinds of molecules are there. There is no molecules, there is no biomolecules, there is no biomolecules, there is no life. No life means no us. No us, no physics, no chemistry would have not been studying this. What does it mean that but we exist? What does this mean is it infers that there is some flaw in Rutherford's model. So the thing is, what is this flaw? So how one thing some people get confused, like previously when I talked to, so I'll just electron, when it is moving in a circular path, it means it is doing some accelerated motion. Why? Because at every point electron is changing its direction of the velocity will be changed. That's why it is following circular path. And while even the direction, if it is changed, there must be some force acting on this. And that force, if force is there, there is definitely acceleration, because electron is a particle, we have seen. It's a cathode ray, it's a particle. Like Newton's second law, you can see. And later on, I don't want to discuss it, that you'll find that if you break a this acceleration into two components, it will be tangential acceleration, radial acceleration. It is a radial acceleration which basically bends the direction of velocity. So electrons, even it is moving in a circular path, it is under accelerated motion. And if it is under the accelerated motion, it will definitely radiate its energy, because any charged particle, not only electrons, any charged particle, it radiates electromagnetic radiation. So, but few things that we got from Rutherford's model are mostly it is protons and neutrons. They reside in the inside the nucleus. It's the and electrons outside the nucleus. So based on that, few terms came which has some implications later on that we will see. So we'll learn those terms like atomic number. Atomic number, it is represented as Z. Most of the textbook around the, in the chemistry will see it represents, I mean in physics, atomic number as Z. So what is Z? Z is defined as number of protons present in the nucleus. It's an atomic number. What does it mean? So you, if you will see the we also know that the charge on protons, the positive charge on protons, the magnitude, its magnitude is exactly equal to the magnitude of negative charge on electrons. So if the number of protons are equal to the number of electrons, if somewhere in any system, I'm saying not only the atoms, it will be the system entire, that part, that body will be electrically neutral. And we know that atoms are electrically neutral. It means that the number of protons in atoms that reside in the nucleus will be equal to the number of electrons which are outside the nucleus. And thus, atomic number will also be equal to number of electrons in the neutral atom. Neutral atom, if I say it is always neutral, if there is some negative charge, it will called anion. You just learn these terms. If there is some negative charge, it is anion. If there is some positive charge, it is cation. They are not atoms. They are ions. So again, I'll repeat again. The atomic number is number of protons present in nucleus, which is equal to number of electrons in the neutral atom. And then, as I said, the next term is nucleons that we will learn. That protons and neutrons both reside inside the nucleus. So they are present in the nucleus. They are collectively called as nucleons because they reside in nucleus. So nucleons means the number of, if I say how, nucleons means you have to add number of protons and number of neutrons. And this also represents the mass number. So one mass number, it's represented as its symbol is A. It is the number of protons plus number of neutrons, means number of nucleons is mass number. So, and one more thing that you at this juncture you should know, that one proton has a mass roughly equal to one atomic unit. It is not exactly, quite roughly equals to one atomic unit. And one neutron also has a mass roughly equals to one atomic unit. So, and electrons has very smaller mass in comparison to protons and neutrons. It is 840 times smaller. Some books say 1835 times smaller. It doesn't matter. The 5, this comes into the error bar of the calculations. So it's a quite lighter than, electrons are quite lighter than protons and neutrons. So what it means that atomic mass will be roughly equal to the mass number of the atom. So if you just add the number of protons and number of neutrons, whatever it will be, you can see that this is the atomic mass of roughly in atomic unit. And this will help you in solving numerical problems, because at some point of time you will see atomic mass. You cannot remember all the atomic masses at 3 or 4 places of decimal in atomic units. It's impossible for anyone. So, but you can remember roughly, this is the integral numbers, mass numbers, and based on that, if you do calculations, you will get the answer correct up to the first place of decimal. That's quite good, and you don't have to worry to remember all the atomic masses and all. So it will help you. So mass number is also equal, roughly equal to atomic mass that you will see. And based on those atomic masses, you can calculate all the mass numbers. You can calculate the molecular mass of a compound, then the molar mass that means, and all these things will help you. So the total number of nucleons is termed as, so it is written there, so, but so far so good. So then we'll learn few more terms. And these terms are important to know because at many places we'll see they had some significance. And so we'll see these are isotopes, isobars, and isotones. In atom, later on in chemical bonding and probably also in periodic properties chapter, those chapters, we will see some another term, isoelectronics. So we'll see that. So this is the composition of, before that, going to these terms, let's see that how an atom is represented symbolically. So composition of an atom can be represented by using normal elemental symbol. Like elemental symbol means if it is hydrogen, hydrogen its symbol is H. So instead of X that we have represented here, you can use H. If it is a neon, you can use Ne. It's a symbol of neon. Argon, it is Ar. Some books also say it's A, but Ar, most of the books follow. So the symbol X with superscript on the left-hand side, like this is superscript, this A, is a mass number or atomic mass basically. As I said, mass number is roughly equal to atomic mass. So it's represented here, and the superscript on the left-hand side, and a subscript on the left-hand side is Z, it is a atomic number on the left-hand side. So this is how an atom is represented. Or an element also is represented. This is the X is the symbol of the element, A is the atomic mass, and Z is the atomic number. Atomic mass, atomic number, remember, don't get confused here. Now we will define the isotopes. So isotopes are atoms having same atomic number but different mass numbers. But in the same, sometimes what it has been found that all the elements, naturally occurring elements, if you read the composition of their atoms, we'll find that all the different atoms all have same atomic number but different masses. Not all, most of the elements, atoms have same mass, but sometimes some deviations are there. So it is because of the number of neutrons varies in the nucleus. It is not number of protons. So since number of protons are same, it will be the number of electrons will be the same. Chemical properties are same. That's why it is the same element. Considered as atoms of same elements, so they show same chemical. I don't have to repeat it again. So atoms having same atomic number but different mass numbers are called isotopes. For example, we see the iodine, and as I said, almost all the elements, naturally occurring elements we have found, they have naturally occurring isotopes as well, almost all. And that's why the atomic mass of different elements also we see it is in a fraction. One of the reason is because there are different isotopes and their percentage composition is different. Like in case of chlorine, if we see chlorine 17-35, it's around, in nature it found around 75%. And chlorine 17-37, around 25% naturally occurring chlorine is chlorine 37. That's why if you see it is atomic mass of chlorine is around 35.5 around in any textbook, and even in periodic table you will see. So one example is that iodine we see. There are four isotopes that has been referred here. The atomic number of iodine is 53. It means what does it mean? The all the elements, this you can see the atomic number is same. Here, the subscript, but on the superscript we can see on the left hand side is different. 123, 125, 127, 131. What does it mean? The mass number is different or atomic mass is different. So these four are different isotopes of iodine. Similarly, these two very famous isotopes of chlorine. There is another very important isotopes that there are two more examples that are. Mostly, you will see they are quite often used in chemical reactions to do something, to understand few reactions. So this is hydrogen that we usually know, the hydrogen 1-1. So So what does it mean? The hydrogen has in its nucleus, there is one proton, and its mass number, atomic mass is also one, but mass number is also one. What does it mean? But it means that mass number is number of protons plus number of neutrons. The number of protons is one. So what will be the number of neutrons? It will be zero. That's why the mass number of hydrogen atom is one. It means that hydrogen atom that doesn't have any neutron in its nucleus. But its isotope, another isotope, you can see the deuterium, we also represent as D. So we can see D12 like this. But here I have shown it's a hydrogen basically. So hydrogen 1, 2, it means number of protons is 1 and number of neutron is 1 here. 1 plus 1, the mass number becomes 2. There is another isotope, tritium, and this isotope. These three atoms have same atomic number but different atomic masses. So they are, and tritium is also, its symbol is T, and we all people also represent it as H13. So it's up to you, whatever you follow, but this is better to understand because this is a chemically hydrogen itself. So in many chemical reactions to understand the kinetics, people use deuterium, and sometimes even to find the age of wine, people use tritium. I don't know if you, numerical problems you may see where these terms have been used. Another thing is carbon, are the carbon isotopes. Carbon 6 and carbon 12, carbon 6 and 13 you see, and carbon 14, 614. So carbon 14 is used to calculate the age of any fossil, whatever you get from the excavation of old minerals or something like that. So it tells you the age. Based on this, it radiates energy alpha particles, and you will see how old it is. Also, later on, we will see that carbon 14, say NMR technique that has been developed on carbon 14 or something like that. People have used it, and later on, it helps to understand the structure of different newly synthesized compounds. So these are isotopes. Isotopes, again, I will say same atomic number, different mass numbers. They are atoms of same elements. Then there comes the terms isobars. Isobars are atoms having same mass number but different atomic numbers. See that atomic numbers different, different number of protons, different number of electrons. So they are atoms of different elements. Different elements, that's why we can see here the symbols I am using for these are all different because they are different elements. They are atoms of different elements. So example of isobars are chlorine 1740, one isotope of chlorine. You can see chlorine here, we saw two isotopes. Here it is the third isotope of chlorine, 1714, argon 1840, potassium 1940, calcium 2040. These are the mass number we can see here. On the superscript is same, but the atomic number is different. They are that's why they are different elements. They are called isobars. Again, we know what is that carbon 14 isotope. This isotope of carbon and nitrogen, we know its mass number is 14. So here I made a mistake, it is 6. Actually, it's a bearer. This carbon 614 is a nitrogen 714. So you just make a correction here, it is a nitrogen 714. The mass number is, I'll just correct it here because it may confuse you. So it's so they are also isobars. Then comes the isotones. Isotones are same number of, they have same number of neutrons in the nucleus. Like example is argon 3818, potassium 3919. This, you can see the two isotopes of potassium. The potassium 1939 and potassium 1940. For potassium 1935, its percentage composition is more in the naturally occurring samples or its rocks whatever you say. So this is the number of neutrons in argon 1838 is how much? You can say 20. 38 minus 18. Number of neutrons here 39 minus 19, 20. So 20, 20. Again in calcium 40 minus 20. The number of neutrons is 20. So 20, 20, 20. So they are isotones. Again, if we see hydrogen 1, 3, helium 2, 4. Hydrogen 1, 3 has how many neutrons? 2, 3 minus 1, 2. Here helium 2, 4. What means 4 minus 2, 2. So they have same number of neutrons. So they are isotones. The fourth thing that I said, just mentioned, the isoelectronics, you will see. They have all the, these, they are different species. They could be ions, they could be compounds. They, so they have same number of electrons. Like if we, I say, you know, neon, what is the atomic number of neon? It is 10. So it has 10 number of electrons. How much are there in neons? It is 10. If I say nitride, nitride has N3 minus. There are three negative charge on nitrogen. When it is there, it is called nitride. So nitrogen had number of electrons 7, and three extra electrons we have put into the nitrogen. So 7 plus 3, it is 10. So nitride and neon, they are isoelectronic. Again, like oxide, O2 minus on oxygen. So it's oxide. This is, it is also isoelectronic to neon and nitride. Then fluoride, they are isoelectronic. Again, if you go to go further, like Na plus, usually the atomic number of sodium is 11. We remove one electron, it will become Na plus. So 11, you remove one, 10. This is also isoelectronic to the Mg2 plus. Many examples. Not only this, even in compounds you can see, like for example ammonia. Ammonia, how many electrons are there? 7 of nitrogen and 3 of three hydrogens. So total number of electrons are 10. In water, if we see, 8 electrons are in oxygen and 2 from 2 different hydrogens. So it is 8 plus 2, 10. Again, these are isoelectronic. Similarly, you can say H2S, HCl, they are isoelectronic. There are many examples, and these things you will see in periodic properties. It will help you to understand some properties of elements, and also in chemical bonding, it will help you to understand like VSEPR theory and later on. So now the next model of atom was like these things actually from the just came after the Rutherford's definition of nucleus, and so it was given there. But the next atomic model, the meaningful model, was given by Niels Bohr. So results obtained from the studies of interactions of radiations with matter, like as I have said, like Maxwell's theory, have provided very useful information regarding the structure of atoms and molecules. And this led to the development of quantum physics or quantum chemistry. Later on, we will see some mention is there, just a beginning, just a development of how the history of quantum physics that we will see at your level. Later, you don't have to worry about other things. So Niels Bohr utilized these results to improve upon the model proposed by Rutherford. The two important developments that has happened by the time of Niels Bohr are this. Niels Bohr was, I think, also the student of Rutherford. So these are the two developments. That one thing is dual character of electromagnetic radiation, as I just mentioned, which means that radiations possess both wave-like and particle-like properties. Earlier, Maxwell's theory and you will see wave optics, you will see that waves are basically there. All the radiations are basically waves, mostly. Even before that, the waves are particles, like something Newton proposed, like capsules or something. That was a different thing. Later on, the a modified theory came as a wave, that radiations are waves. And then experimental results regarding atomic spectra. Later, people also found the hydrogen spectra of hydrogen atoms. And these two things actually suggested something different, or something based on those things. Rutherford gave a new model of atomic structure. But before that, we'll see this dual character of electromagnetic radiation. how it developed. So wave nature of electromagnetic radiation we will see first, and later on we will see the particle nature of electromagnetic radiation. So if both the nature means dual nature. So James Maxwell in 1870 was the first to give a comprehensive explanation about the interaction between the charged bodies and the behavior of electrical and magnetic field on macroscopic level. He suggested that when an electrically charged particle moves under acceleration, alternating electrical and magnetic fields are produced and transmitted. And these magnetic, electric and magnetic fields, they move perpendicular to each other. And the wave moves even perpendicular to both the direction of this vibrations of these fields. So these fields are transmitted in forms of wave called electromagnetic waves or electromagnetic radiation. We will see this further. So the theory of electromagnetic waves and emission of such waves by accelerating charged particles was developed. Developed in early 1870 by James Clerk Maxwell, this was theory. He gave some equations, he explained based on that what is the nature of electromagnetic radiations, but any theory must be confirmed by some experiments. And Henrik Hertz, you know this person, frequency, the per second hertz, it is the same based on the name of this Henrik Hertz that is given. So experimentally confirmed by Henrik Hertz. Henrik Hertz also did some very important experiments before this photoelectric effect. I think it will be there in your course. So in earlier days, Newton, as I said, that Newton's even before this nature of this wave nature of electromagnetic radiations, Newton earlier said it's a particle wave, is a particle, it's corpuscles. Maxwell was first one to reveal that light is an electromagnetic radiation. That's the thing, the same repetition. So electromagnetic radiation is a form of energy that is produced by oscillating electric and magnetic disturbances or by accelerated motion of electrically charged particle traveling through a vacuum or matter. Can travel even through vacuum or even through any matter. So in this figure you can see there are two different planes. This plane, this y along this y axis in y plane, and this z plane, they are perpendicular to each other, these planes. In this plane, this magnetic field component is there, and upon the other plane, the z axis plane, you can see it is the electric field, and the electromagnetic waves moves perpendicular to this in x-axis direction. So these three components of electromagnetic radiations are perpendicular to each other. This is how the nature, what is the nature of electromagnetic radiation. The electric, the same thing, radiation is released as photons. I will see photons much later. Which is the bundles of light. So this came later. Somehow it got there. Unlike sound waves or wave produced in water, electromagnetic waves do not require medium and can move even in vacuum. So that's the thing that we saw. And there are a few properties of electromagnetic radiations that we use because of their waves. So wave, what is those properties based on that? They have certain characteristics like amplitude. All the waves have amplitude, wavelength, and frequency. In vacuum, all types of electromagnetic radiations, regardless of their wavelength or frequency, whatever you say, travel at the same speed. And this speed is called speed of light. And its symbol is C. And the speed of light is roughly equal to 3.0 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. And it is 2.99. So that you don't worry. You remember 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second is the speed of light. And all the type of electromagnetic radiations, remember this, all type of, you know that even sunlight is made of seven, even visible light is seven different colors. But all these different colors move with the same speed. That is why we do not detect it so easily. And this is called speed of light. The frequency, it is represented as nu, wavelength lambda, and velocity c are related by the equation c is equal to nu lambda. This equation, you remember, C is equal to nu lambda. This is for all waves, not only for the lights or electromagnetic radiation. For all kind of waves, you can see that, but this c is, you can say v. V is velocity of a wave, and this you can see nu lambda, or see, some books also say n lambda. So the other commonly used quantity, specifically in spectroscopy, is wave number. Sometimes I don't know at your stage it is there, but it was mentioned in your NCERT book, so I put it there. So it is a wave number. Wave number is what number of waves in one unit distance, means 1 meter distance, how many waves are there. So how will you calculate? So number of waves, number of wave means what? One complete oscillation from one point to the other point. So actually I am making, so like this. This is from here, this is called one wave. So whatever that's a wavelength. So number of waves, you can count and divide it by length. You divide it, the length that wave has traveled, so you can find the wave number. So its unit is per meter, right? Number of waves, it's a number, so it's unitless. And per unit length means you divide by length. So length, SI unit is meter, so it's per meter. 1 divided by meter is per meter. But however, commonly used unit in chemistry is centimeter in mass. And not SI, in chemistry we generally don't use SI unit for wave number. So there is one question that we will see, one example. The Vivid Bharati station of All India Radio broadcasts on a frequency of 1368 kilohertz. Calculate the wavelength of electromagnetic radiation emitted by transmitter. Which part, and the next part of the question is, which part of electromagnetic spectrum does it belong to? So the what, how will we see the what is given? Given is the frequency. We see here what we know already is the velocity of light or electromagnetic radiation. This value, what we have to find out is lambda. Here in this, c is given, nu is given. Now c we know, nu is given, lambda we want to calculate. So from this equation we can say lambda is equal to c by nu. C by c value we can put here, and nu is this kilohertz, but we want to put it in the same kind of unit. What does it mean? It's a kilohertz. So kilohertz means 10 to the power 3. Kilo means 10 to the power 3. In my first class I have probably explain this, how will you convert units. So 10 to the power 3 per second, and if, when you do the calculation, you will get a number 219.3 meter. So this is the wavelength of the what? The Vivid Bharati broadcast, whatever the, you know, this wavelength, this transmitter emits the radiation. This is the next part then is, which part of electromagnetic spectrum does it belong to? I'll say this is part of radio waves. But how do you know? You have to remember a few things. So we need to understand electromagnetic spectrum, because if you don't know, we cannot answer the second part of the question. So to understand, then we will see the electromagnetic spectrum. So this is electromagnetic spectrum. It is made up of different kind of rays, and all these rays, they have different ranges of wavelength, and they are called as that range is in particular kind of radiation. So the wave with highest energy is the gamma rays, then X rays, then ultraviolet rays, UV rays we say, then visible range means in which we see, and infrared rays. Then infrared rays, why? Because if we see the spectrum, this spectrum here, like the visible range. So this is the red of the visible light. After that is infrared. And this is ultraviolet. The first part is the violet. So we pure this V. So this is a violet. So this is called ultraviolet. So just to remember this, infrared rays, then comes, then microwave, you know, microwave ovens we use. Then radio waves, we see all the broadcasting radio if you have used in your life. And so even in the mobile phones, you can use radios. So the radio waves, they have different kind of this frequency. See, more the frequency, one thing you remember, higher the frequency, higher is the energy of the rays. You can see the frequency 10 to the power in the order of 20 order of magnitude, 18 order of magnitude, 16. Like see, you can see in the visible range where it will come around 10 to the power 13 to 10 to the power 14. Here again, frequency is going down. Frequency is going down, then we know the equation, what this equation, C is equal to nu lambda, frequency is less, C is constant, then lambda will increase accordingly. So we can see here, this is a smaller number, much smaller number than this one. How much it is smaller? It is 10 to the power 9 times smaller than this. This one is 10 to the power 9 minus 9 times smaller. Anyway, I don't want to go into mathematics. So see wavelength you can see here. And this is visible range. Visible range we need to understand here. And how will you remember this? The spectra, so we know that its term is given. So what is this? V, violet, I, indigo, B, from here to here. This is how we know I have referred, but the spectrum shows in the different order. So this order I am saying, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. We know people remember. Then another thing that you will remember is this equation, perhaps later on in the Planck's theory, you will see. And from this equation, also that now it has, I think we don't need to understand this at this point. So characteristics of waves, so then we will see the what characteristics we said. It just is summarized here, like waves have amplitude. Was it is amplitude? In physics class, in your wave optics chapter, you will see everything and it will be explained very nicely. Just mentioning here, because this is part of the chemistry and this is how chemistry was developed. And this will also help you to understand physics and then the chemistry as well. So amplitude is maximum vertical displacement of wave from the mean position. Amplitude is directly related to the intensity of the wave. We will see that intensity is proportional to the amplitude square. So then wavelength is the distance between two corresponding points on a wave. As I said, like suppose there's a transverse wave. So from this point to this point is a wavelength. Shorter wavelength means greater frequency, and greater frequency means higher energy. I have mentioned it. So these points you should remember. Then again come to then the third term is frequency. Frequency is defined as the number of cycles per second and is expressed as second one, second inverse or hertz, as I said earlier. So what is the number of frequencies? Suppose this is one wave. What? This is one wave. So how many such waves are forming in 1 second? That number is called frequency. Not only if suppose a particle is moving circular, doing the motion in a circular, revolving around some particle is doing a circular motion. So there also we say frequency. How many cycle it completes in 1 second is called frequency. In the circular motion, you will see that equation as well. It will help you to understand alternating current or other things anyway. So period, the third term is period. Period is the amount of time a wave takes to travel one wavelength. What does it mean? So you can probably you will be able to see this. So this is one wavelength. So time a wave takes from moving from here to here, this time is called a period or time period. And the amount of travel one wavelength, it is measured in seconds. Anyway, so this is measured in second. The velocity, then v. For a normal wave, as I said earlier, v is equal to lambda nu or nu lambda. V is nu is frequency, v is velocity. And for light waves, we say v is c, represented c. So it's c is equal to nu lambda. Or for a normal wave, it is v is equal to nu lambda. Then wave number again I defined is how much it's defined as a number of wavelengths per unit length. Unit is meter per second. Commonly used unit is centimeter per second. So we saw till now wave nature of electromagnetic radiation. Then what is the other part is the particle nature of electromagnetic radiation. The particle nature of electromagnetic radiation, before that, let's see few points. Some of the experimental phenomena like, you know, diffraction. What is the diffraction? Diffraction is bending of a light at any obstacle is called diffraction. X-ray diffraction, all these kind of things you will some mention is there in your course in chemistry, I think, in solid state chemistry. Then the interference, you know, if there are two waves, they come together, they interfere, the amplitude, everything will be a vector sum of other things. So maybe sometime magnitude, you can add the frequency and all. We will see in your physics thing. So these are characters of diffraction, interference are properties of waves. So So electromagnetic radiation show these properties. There are waves. However, some of the experimental observations could not explain with the help of electromagnetic theory of 19th century. That was given by particularly by Maxwell's theory. That is 19th century physics is called classical physics. It was started by Newton, then Rutherford, then many people like Huygens. And then Maxwell, these people, they are all the classical physics theory. So they, what are those properties? So four examples are given here. There were a few more, but four is very famous, four are, and you should know about this. The nature of emission of radiation from hot bodies like black body radiation. So black body radiation cannot explain based on this classical laws of physics. Now, second is ejection of electrons from metal surface when radiation strikes it. The photoelectric effect, this was first discovered probably by Heinrich Hertz, and it was explained by Einstein, you will see. Why this photoelectric effect phenomena, we will see. Then the variation of heat capacity of solids as a function of temperature. The fourth is the line spectra of hydrogen atoms. So based on the classical theory, people were expecting that the spectra would be the continuous, but we don't get continuous spectra of any atom. We see line spectra. What could be the reason for that? So these phenomena indicate that the system can take energy only in discrete amounts. All these four phenomena, this can be explained when you consider that energy only exists in discrete amount or not a continuous emission or continuous energy. All possible energies, energies cannot be taken up or radiated. Taken up means absorbed or radiated. All possible energy cannot be taken up. Then we'll see radiation. What is the radiation? The hot objects emit electromagnetic radiations over a wide range of wavelengths, like sun. It emits radiation. That's why we see temperature is there on Earth and light is there. At high temperatures, an appreciable proportion of radiation is in visible region of a spectrum, like sun spectrum. It is a visible region of the spectrum. That is why we will be able to see any object in the sunlight. And this is a reason why our eyes is developed to see in visible region. If we have evolved on this Earth and in presence of sunlight, so we are evolved to see in the visible region, because most part of the sunlight, the higher intensity comes from the visible region. For example, when an iron rod, then again, as temperature is raised, if any object you raise the temperature, a higher proportion of short wavelength like blue light is generated. But we say initially it will glow like red, then it will become blue, or white, then it will become blue. For example, when an iron rod is heated in a furnace, it first turns to dull red, then progressively becomes more and more red as the temperature increases. As this is heated further, the radiation emitted becomes white and then becomes blue as the temperature becomes very high. We have seen, you can also see somewhere if some people like are working. This means intensities of radiations of different wavelengths emitted by hot bodies depends upon its temperature. By late 1850s, it was known that objects made of different materials and kept at different temperatures emit different amounts of radiation. Also, when the surface of an object is irradiated with light electromagnetic radiation, a part of radiant energy is generally reflected as such, and a part is absorbed and a part of it is transmitted. What is if we expose any particle, any object with any radiation? Some radiation is natural that it will get reflected. You will see most of the object you see. That's why we see different objects. Some portion it gets absorbed. That's why any you radiate energy on any object, it gets heated. And so that's why there is a heat on Earth. Even you see in sunlight, the surface becomes hot. This is the thing. The third part is that if the material is not, its dimension is small, not very large, then some part of rays it will move through, percolates through the material, and it will transmit at the other surface. It will come out at the other surface. It is called transmission. So it is transmitted. So there are three things. So the reason of our incomplete absorption, so the thing is, it is not totally absorbed. Light is not totally absorbed. Some is reflected, some is transmitted. The reason for incomplete absorption is that ordinary objects are, as a rule, imperfect absorber of radiation. Ordinary objects, they are not perfect absorber of radiation. You will see these things even again in physics. They are part of physics. So people have devised one, say, the hypothetical body. It is not ideal, perfect absorber, but it is quite close to ideal perfect absorber. It's called black body radiation. It's an ideal body which emits and absorbs radiations of all frequencies uniformly. It absorbs all light. It doesn't reflect, it doesn't transmit. It's called a black body, and radiation emitted by such a body is called black body radiation. In practice, no such body exists. Carbon black approximates fairly closely to black body. Sun you can also consider as a black body. A good physical approximation to a black body is cavity with a tiny hole. What people have made, like this is a cavity they made, and the carbon black they use in the inner surface, and with a tiny hole, the light pass through that tiny hole, and once it get into the hole, I means inside the body, it will remain there. It will reflect from one surface, go to the other surface, the third surface, and this is how it will get completely absorbed. So which has no other opening. Any ray entering the hole will be reflected by the cavity walls and will be eventually absorbed by the walls. A black body is also a perfect radiator of radiant energy. You will again see these things in physics. A black body is in thermal equilibrium with its surrounding. So once it absorbs energy, body gets heated. Once it gets heated, then it starts from the surface. It will also starts radiating. Later on, then it radiates same amount of energy per unit area as it absorbs from its surrounding in any given time. So this is thermal equilibrium. What does it mean? Whatever amount energy it absorbs, it radiates same amount of energy. After some time, it goes into the equilibrium. Initially, it doesn't. Once you start, it is not in equilibrium. But after some time, it keeps absorbing the energy and it achieves the equilibrium. The amount of light emitted from a black body and its spectral distribution depends only on its temperature. We see here its temperature. So you change the temperature, the graph, the nature is changed. Temperature at a given temperature, intensity of radiation emitted increases with increase of wavelength, reaches a maximum value at a given wavelength, and then starts decreasing with further increase of wavelength. You see here the same. This is, we can see once you start the wavelength, increasing the wavelength, the black body wavelength of radiation, the intensity will increase initially, then it will at the temperature T2, and it's then start decreasing. You keep the body at different temperature, it will follow this path. So initially, again, it will increase, the intensity will increase, and it will go down further. So this nature is same, but once the temperature you increase, this graph shifts to left. This graph shifts to left, but based on, if you see the then whatever the theory was, that people will know, theoretical representation of electromagnetic radiation, these kind of things. What you expect is this kind of graphs. But this kind of graph means intensity will keep increasing once you decrease the wavelength. Like here, we are decreasing the wavelength from right to left, the intensity is increasing, and it reaches to maxima, then it started decreasing. But based on the theory of 19th century, what you expect is it will keep increasing and it will become infinite at zero wavelength. But we don't see really at this nature, this graph, kind of graph is seen for even all kind of absorber, not only for black body. People started observing it from the black body. So what does it mean? What you expect, it will increase, but it goes in the ultraviolet. This is the visible region, basically ultraviolet regions. This is called ultraviolet catastrophe. What was expected is not, we don't see it. So the amount of light emitted from a black body and its spectral distribution depends only on its temperature. This Huh, so they could not explain by satisfaction on the basis of wave theory of light. As I said, this was expectation, but we got this. This cannot be explained on the based on those theory. And one thing that I want to mention here is, whatever the maximum intensity light source has, this intensity tells the basic nature we see and observe, perceive about that light. So sunlight, we see the most of the higher intensity, as I said earlier, it is in the visible region. So that's why we see in the sunlight. This theory, this thing is used even in making electric bulbs. So if you heat the body to a certain very high temperature, it starts glowing, because most of the light will be in the visible region. And that thing, you don't have to increase even further. You increase further, it will go to ultraviolet region, then again it will be dark for you. Then Planck explained this theory of black body radiation, and this is called Planck's quantum theory. This is what he said: the light is not a continuous source, means it's a emission, any kind of emission, electromagnetic radiation, it cannot take all energies. But light is quantized, he suggested. When a black body is heated, it emits thermal radiation of different wavelengths or frequency. To obtain, to explain these radiations, Max Planck put forward a theory known as Planck's quantum theory. It seeds the thing of whatever the quantum physics then started. Substances radiate or absorb energy discontinuously in the form of a small packets or bundles of energy. The smallest packet of energy is called quantum. So these things further actually were more clarified by Einstein. But it see the basic theory was quantum. So everything is in the, your books are mentioned here. But if you read, go into higher studies, you will see that these are pockets and these Carl photons. These were explained mostly by the Einstein later on. But the basic theory is same. So the smallest packet of energy is called quantum. It case of quantum is known as photons. So, and the, but the basic difference that we will see is what he said. Even black body does not is made up of many small oscillators, atomic oscillators. These things perhaps you don't know, need to learn those things. And it absorbs those packets of energy, that those quantums. So, but it absorbs whatever it absorbs, it will emit that. And it emit that, whatever it will emit, that wavelength will remain be there. What is it? It emits wavelength of visible range more, absorbs more, so it will emit more of that wavelength. It emits, absorbs wavelength in ultraviolet region or even gamma, very small part of sunlight, it is there, it consists of that. So it doesn't emit. So that's why you get that this nature of the graph. It absorbs here more, so it will emit here more. The body can radiate or absorb energy in whole number of multiples of quantum, the h nu to us, in a, it is called h nu. Later on, the what's the, he concluded that Lewis, okay, Broglie suggested that particle, electrons, photons, etc. have dual nature. So the thing is, the this Planck suggested that the radiation, the electromagnetic waves are the particle nature, and de Broglie suggests even particles are of wave nature. So wave theory of electromagnetic radiations explains the phenomena of interference, diffraction, polarization. On the other hand, quantum theory explains the photoelectric effect that we will see in our next class, black body radiation that we just saw, and X-ray spectra. In no experiment, matter exists both as particle and a wave simultaneously. These two aspects are complementary to each other. That's called a wave particle duality. And then comes the photoelectric effect. I think we will see this thing again in the next class, probably, which will probably on Sunday. So I'll stop this here.
Welcome to Sushruta app. In this video we are going to demo NEET topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select biology 11th as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the first subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the third icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from IIT PAL. If there are more than one video, select any one of the links and watch the video. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, taxonomic categories, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook. So here we have the textbook resource showing taxonomic categories. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Biology Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the biology syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is Gyan Chat. Gyan Chat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box displaying the page number of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Now let us see the formula sheet for physics. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF. In some cases, there will be video content, graphic and interactive content. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Hello my dear students. Very glad to meet you all. I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. In 2018 or during 2018 to 2020, I got an opportunity to visit nearly 25 institutions.
and I used to teach in all these institutions biology, preparing the students for NEET exam. For NEET exam, you must be thorough with each and every word given in the NCERT books. That means biology, you have to by heart the NCERT book. Not simply by heart, understanding the concept and by heart. That is what is expected. Now let us start with this particular chapter, that is Animal Kingdom. And we shall look into the various components that is given here in the NCERT, in the Animal Kingdom chapter. Under basis of classification. What we are looking, what characters, what points we are looking to classify the animals. That is what we are studying under basis of classification. In spite of differences in structure and form of different animals, there are a lot of differences in the structure, in their form, gross morphology. There are certain fundamental features common to various individuals. There are certain features common to various individuals in relation to arrangement of cells, body symmetry, nature of coelom, patterns of digestive system, circulatory system, or ecosystem.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.